Madam President.
Senator from Ohio.
Thank you, Madam President. I first thank Senator Sanders for his passionate support for housing. He understands, having traveled the country and connected with so many people, that there is almost nothing more important, maybe nothing more important to people's lives, to the material lives, than having a safe, accessible, affordable house, place to live. And Senator Sanders mentioned that 25% of renters in this country pay half their income in rent and in for housing costs. And one thing goes bad in their lives: their car breaks down, their child gets sick, they miss a few days of work because of a minor injury, and their whole lives can turn upside down. Senator Sanders recognizes that. And the legislation we begin later in the week is such an important step, as the presiding officer knows, as a member of the Banking Housing Committee, that we're going to take on housing. So Senator Sanders, thank you for that. Madam President, I ask unanimous consent that Ben Lockshin, the DTLE, and the Banking and Housing Committee be granted floor privileges for the remainder of the session.
Without objection.
Thank you, Madam President. I rise today, a longer speech than I normally give, but in support of the legislation that will make generational investment in infrastructure for Ohio communities, for our nation, the infrastructure investment we should have been making for years. We remember 4 years ago, all of us on this floor, all three members on this floor, the presiding officer and Senator Sanders and I, were all ready to go with President Trump to move forward on infrastructure. And the president and the majority changed its mind. Instead of investing in jobs, investing in infrastructure, investing in people, they used that $1 trillion plus in a huge tax cut, 70% of which went to the wealthiest 1%. So this time we didn't let that happen. I thank the 22 members, 11 Republicans and 11 Democrats, that held together and negotiated this very complicated bill. This investment is about jobs, creating good paying union jobs, rebuilding bridges, replacing lead pipes, manufacturing next generation energy efficient buses. It's about better connecting people with jobs through transit and bridges and highways. It's about getting people in rural Kansas or Western Mass or Southeast Ohio or inner city Cleveland the broadband they need to go to school and prepare for the jobs of the future. Supporting manufacturing jobs throughout my state, which this bill does, including at Cleveland Cliffs in Cleveland and AK Steel in Southwest Ohio and Nucor in Central Ohio and other suppliers through the strongest ever Buy America standards, negotiated working with Senator Portman, legislation that we worked on with Senator Baldwin, making steel and iron and other components in Ohio for all these projects. Taken together, these investments are a recipe for job creation in communities large and small, rural and urban Ohio, from Appalachia to the shores of Lake Erie. For too long, Washington has ignored these places while Wall Street has preyed upon them. That ends now. We invest in people and places that make this country work. I hear from mayors of both parties in towns all over Ohio about their vision for their community and the projects they want to undertake. They know the opportunities we can unleash. They need the investment. It's time for all of our communities to share in this country's prosperity. That's what this legislation does. I want to focus on a few key provisions that will be central and critical to Ohio. Right now, there are more than 3,200 bridges across Ohio that need repairs to make them safer and to reduce congestion so people can get to work, kids can get to school, farmers and businesses can move their products and support Ohio jobs. I remember as a kid, I worked on a family farm just outside Lexington, Ohio, and sort of north central Ohio. And we used to, on tractor, I used to drive grain to the market, or we'd take hay wagons to the barn. We would cross some of these small little culvert bridges or bridges across creeks, and some of us called them cricks. And I know how some of those bridges even then look to be in some disrepair, and how important it is that we keep them up for farmers and for small business all over my state. Many know the Brent Spence Bridge, talked about in all kinds of national infrastructure stories. Between Ohio and Kentucky, it carries, unbelievably enough, it carries 3% of the country's GDP. either north to Ohio or south to Kentucky, across the river, 3% of the country's GDP every day, but it's dangerously outdated. It was built in, it was completed, I believe, in 1960. Many of us fought for years for federal investment. One of the first news events, community events I did when I came to the Senate in 2007 is go to the Brent Spence Bridge and express my commitment that we needed to do something. It wasn't in the shape then that it is now, but it clearly needed support and needed help. 3.5 years ago, I introduced the Bridge Investment Act to put Ohioans to work, repairing and upgrading Ohio bridges with American iron and steel. This week, we're on the verge of getting it done. It will provide a grant to pay for half the cost of replacing Brent Spence, and the additional funding in the package will support the remainder of the project. We expect Ohio to get at least $9.8 billion for federal aid highway assistance, including $480 million of formula funds for bridge replacement to supplement the Bridge Investment Act. It's not just Brent Spence that needs help. It's the Western Hills Viaduct in Hamilton County. It's I-70 over the Scioto River in Columbus and Franklin County. It's US 30 in Richland County in North Central Ohio. It's the Broad Street Bridge in Columbus. It's major projects and smaller bridges on rural farmlands that let farmers get goods to market. I talked this week with 81-year-old Howard Kruger. He lives in Wyoming, Ohio, outside of Cincinnati. He's retired from Procter & Gamble. A few years ago, as he was driving, a piece of the Western Hills Viaduct fell on his windshield. He stopped his car, got out, picked up the rock, about as big as his fist, a little bigger than his fist, took it with him, talked about it in a radio news conference we did. It's a pretty visceral example of what we all know. Our nation's infrastructure is literally crumbling. We need this investment. Think about the economic potential waiting to be unleashed when we fix these crumbling bridges, the kind of bottlenecks that frustrate commuters and farmers and businesses in Ohio every day. Madam President, I want to thank our bipartisan co-sponsors of the Bridge Investment Act, Senators Wyden, the chair of the Senate Finance Committee, Senator Whitehouse, Senator Inhofe from Oklahoma, Senator Whitehouse from Rhode Island, early partners in this effort. I want to thank Chairman Carper and Ranking Member Capito, just across the river from Southeast Ohio, from West Virginia, the EPW Committee for their continued support. Madam President, the Banking and Housing Committee also provide a major part of this infrastructure package. It includes record investment in public transportation. Presiding Officer sits on this as a prominent member of this committee. She knows, as I know, that through her career and through my career, for a decade and a half, as long as I remember, this committee is just referred to by the media and by senators as the Banking Committee. It was all about Wall Street. It was little about community banks. It was almost nothing about housing. That's changed. This committee now we all refer to is the Banking and Housing Committee. Some refer to it as the Housing and Banking Committee. And in this committee, we take our job with public transit seriously. This package contains historic funding, $90 billion over the next 5 years, $40 billion increase for public transit, the largest ever. It will connect people with better jobs. It'll promote equity. It'll help our planet. The Banking and Housing Committee held extensive hearings this spring on infrastructure and transit. We heard from Ohioans like Daryl Haley, who heads Southwest Ohio, SORTA, Southwest Ohio Regional Transit Authority. We heard from Mayor Horgan of Akron. We heard over and over and over again what we need to revitalize these essential systems, whether in Cleveland, where I live, or Youngstown, or Toledo, or anywhere in our state. We provide $1.5 billion so that cities like Cleveland and Ranking Member Toomey's biggest city in his state, Philadelphia, can replace rail cars that unbelievably date back to the Reagan administration or earlier. This bill ensures that public transportation receives more than 20% of the new investment from the Highway Trust Fund. It's consistent with historic Senator Shelby, once chair of this committee, retiring after 37 years on this committee. He talked to me about that 80-20 split that's been here as long as he's been here, a tradition that both parties have respected. This bill takes a huge step toward electrifying the transit bus fleet, providing over $5 billion for the low and no emission, low emission program. It will mean taking those buses, modernizing the bus fleets in every city in America. These funds will also retrain workers who maintain our current diesel fleet. Every electric bus purchase will keep and create good-paying jobs. This bill will support investments in flood mitigation, an important issue that members of the Banking and Housing Committee, especially Senator Menendez, but a number of senators in both parties who represent coastal states from Massachusetts, the presiding officer state, all the way to Louisiana, Senator Kennedy's state. I want to thank the members of the committee, Banking and Housing Committee, including Ranking Member Toomey, who worked to reauthorize federal transit programs. I particularly want to thank our Housing and Transit Subcommittee Chair, Tina Smith from Minnesota, and the subcommittee's ranking member, Senator Rounds from South Dakota. I've worked with both of them. I've been to their subcommittee. Their efforts have been especially important to improve rural transit, including in Indian Country. We're going to keep working to help rural transit agencies even more. We had hearings under the leadership of Chair Crapo 3 or 4 years ago, where I heard stories from rural senators in smaller states, mostly Republicans, talking about the importance of rural transit, where someone who lives out in the country, a bus, a paratransit bus, picks her up, takes her to her dialysis treatment, and then takes her back. That kind of different from city, urban, big city bus transit, but equally important to families. I thank our Democratic members for their strong focus on transit. Senator Menendez from New Jersey, Senator Reid from Rhode Island continue to be leaders in fighting for a fair share of funds for transit. Senator Tester from Montana, Senator Warner from Virginia played a key role in ensuring the committee's transit title move forward in the bipartisan negotiations. Our committee, the Banking and Housing Committee, owe them special thanks. Senator Warner and Senator Van Hollen from Maryland fought to reauthorize funds for Ohio for America's subway, the Washington, D.C. metro system, serving millions in this region. And Senator Van Hollen's legislation to improve agency safety plans and give workers stronger voice in safety matters is a big victory for labor. The chair of the Labor Committee just walked in, and her work on these issues for, in this case, bus safety, but safety of workers overall is so very important. We know that bus drivers are often a special target, and preserving and protecting them is essential. Senators Warnock and Ossoff, our newest members on the committee from Georgia, helped us fight for better bus rapid transit and better planning, something that Metro Atlanta cries out for, and they've been loud, strong voices on that. Senator Cortez Masto contributed provisions to link transportation planning with housing needs. I want to thank the presiding officer, Senator Warren, and other members of our caucus who kept advocating for zero emission buses, not just for Boston, but for the whole country. These buses help fight the climate crisis. They help clean the air in neighborhoods plagued by air pollution. People in inner cities, more often than not, the quality of the air they breathe is, that's partly because there aren't many trees. It's partly because of public transit. It's a whole host of issues, but this takes a major step in dealing with that. I want to thank Senator Duckworth. The Americans with Disability Act became law 30 years ago, but some 20% of our rail stations still remain inaccessible. My friend Senator Casey, who sits next to me on the floor, chair of the Aging Committee, he and I were proud to co-sponsor her proposal. Her bill provides almost $2 billion for accessibility grants. Senators Duckworth, Casey, and I will continue to push for more resources until every transit station is accessible. I want to thank Senator Sinema, also a member of our committee, and Senator Portman, and other members of the bipartisan group for bringing this momentous infrastructure package together. Madam President, it's obvious how some of the job creation in this package will happen. You build a bridge, you lay down rail tracks, you hire American workers to do it. None of these jobs ever in an infrastructure plan can be shipped overseas. But this investment, Madam President, is different from those that have come before it. For the first time, every single one of these projects will come from the strongest ever Buy America rules. It means we get more job creation from Wichita to Seattle to Boston to Cleveland. We get more job creation for every single dollar of taxpayer investment. Throughout my time in the Senate, I've worked to strengthen our nation's Buy America laws at every opportunity, and there have always been interest groups in this town that have written loopholes into these laws and weakened these laws. For instance, one of the most expensive bridges in American history, the Bay Bridge in Northern California, a loophole enabled it to be made entirely of Chinese steel from a company owned by the Chinese government. Think of that. We talk all the time about China. Our corporations lobby to get tax breaks and trade agreements to outsource jobs to China. We don't see the hypocrisy there. We don't see the hypocrisy in letting China make the steel for the Bay Bridge. But nonetheless, those days are behind us. We know how much steel can go into a bridge and how many steel workers in Cleveland or Middletown or Gary, Indiana can be employed to make the steel. I've worked with colleagues from both sides of the aisle to strengthen Buy America laws in the Highway Bill and the Defense Authorization Act and the Water Resource Development Act. These efforts have been piecemeal. That's why I asked Senator Portman to join me and Senator Baldwin in Build America, Buy America, a bill we introduced on President Trump's Inauguration Day. We've worked with other leaders on Buy America and will continue to. I especially call out Senator Baldwin. 4 years later, we're finally getting it right. We're putting in place a clear, comprehensive standard. American tax dollars should support American jobs, period. American tax dollars should support American jobs, period. These historic investments will support Ohio manufacturers and not their foreign competitors. With potential for hundreds of bridge repair projects alone, this investment in Ohio combined with our strong Buy America rules means job creation in every region of my manufacturing state. It keeps the promise I've made to Ohioans my entire career that I'd fight for the dignity of work. When you love your country, you fight for the people that make it work to ensure the industrial heartland would be the engine of opportunity that drives us into a 21st century economy. Finally, while I'm supporting this bill, I'm excited for all the investments it will make in Ohio communities and Ohio jobs. I'm disappointed that a number of my colleagues rejected the idea that we should pay for this bill by enforcing our country's tax laws. I oppose the provision forcing home buyers to pay more each month to help fund investments that wealthy tax cheats should pay for. The money that home buyers pay should be going towards keeping our housing system stable, making sure that everyone has an affordable home. We can do more. We will do more in the coming months to address affordable housing. You all heard, those that were in the chamber heard Senator Sanders talking about the importance of housing in the reconciliation bill. I will come down to the floor later today and talk in some detail about that. I mean, finally, Madam President, I would be remiss if I not thank my staff for their hard work on this effort. Many of them had planned August vacations. It's the only time of year where they really get sort of untrammeled, unrestricted time with their families, and all of them have given up something already this month in July, and they're public servants for sure. They understand commitment. They do this without complaining. Their hard work has been so obvious to me and so obvious to people that pay attention, not necessarily obvious to my constituents, and I want to call them out. Homer Carlisle was instrumental in helping negotiate and craft the transit title and the bridge legislation. Ben Lockshin, a fellow from the Federal Transit Administration, assisted Homer in these efforts. I want to thank Rebecca Higgins and Mary Frances Repko with Chairman Carper's staff. I've done conference calls with them. My staff works closely with them. Robert Andres with Chairman Wyden. Chairman Wyden is chair of one of the most important committees in this Congress and has been a leader in wanting the wealthy to pay their fair share and wants to make sure it's large corporations that share the taxpayer bill and pay the tax burden and pay their fair share and less burden on small business. Aaron Goldner, formerly with Senator Whitehouse, and my former aide, Leah Hill, they all made the bridge legislation possible. In my office, Beth Cooper provided technical assistance on the very complicated flood mitigation portion of this bill. Megan Cheney and Chad Bolton, Elijah Tuku and Corey Fryer provided the analyses and guidance on matters related to the bill's pay for. Carolina Young, new on my staff, but already making her mark. And Abigail Duggan worked on the Buy America provisions. My staff has worked with others on Buy America over the years, but Sam Woolopoulos with Senator Portman's HISCAC staff, Brian Conley with Senator Baldwin have been particularly helpful. And I want to recognize my former aide, Nora Todd, who led our efforts for much of a decade on Buy America. Through all this, joining me on the floor today, too, is Laura Swanson, my staff director, who works unbelievable hours with a small child and continues to be a terrific mother and wife and an amazing staff director. And I say exactly the same about our legislative director, Jeremy Heckheis, who's not a terrific mother, but a terrific father with a family and has worked so very, very, very hard holding all this together for over a decade. So I thank my staff, I thank my colleagues, this legislation. I remember saying to Senator Casey on March 6th, when we passed the American Rescue Plan, I turned to him because of the child tax credit and what we did with pensions and so much else that Senator Murray had worked on too. I turned to Bob and said, this is the best day of my legislative life, what we're able to do to cut rates of child poverty and so much else. Well, this bill today is almost as big in its scope and is so very important to this country, and I'm pleased to add my support to it. I yield the floor.